The phrase climate change has a very boring ring to it. Just look at how the dictionary defines it for us. A change in global or regional climate patterns, in particular a change apparent from the mid to the late 20th century onwards and attributed largely to the increased levels of atmospheric carbon dioxide produced by the use of fossil fuels. It's technical, it's complex, and something that the do-gooders, the scientists, the naysayers, and the politicians continue to argue about. Painting a doomsday scenario, mathematical models on temperature rise, and idealistic solutions. This has all been done to death. So today, let's leave it all aside because I want to talk about something much, much bigger: world domination. It might sound like I'm exaggerating this a little bit, but there's a reason for it. I want us to really visualize how countries approach climate change is going to determine the geopolitics of the 21st century. While most certainly it may even shape the winners and losers in the next few decades. In fact, I'm even going to stick my neck out and say that it may decide the superpowers of tomorrow. You wonder how? By silently and strategically reshaping the fundamental pillars of global equilibrium. I will talk about three pillars today: leadership, energy, and trade. Let's look at leadership first. I believe that leadership on climate change will be a key driver of political influence this century. It already is in some ways. Let me take you back 5 years in 2015, when the groundbreaking Paris Agreement on climate change was being globally negotiated. Leadership then was naturally provided by the US as the global superpower. With US leading the way, over 190 countries signed the historic agreement. Unfortunately, however, in 2017, the US had to withdraw from the agreement. Amidst all the uncertainty, the world at that time was looking for a climate hero. And that's when China stepped in. Traditionally, you see, to maintain space for the future economic growth, China's position had always accentuated the differing responsibilities between historical responsibility for the climate emissions, that means the Western world, and those that are industrializing now. Despite that position, however, President Xi went on and reassured the world at his address at the UN in Geneva in early 2017. He said, "There is only one Earth in the universe, and we mankind have only one homeland." This was China's pitch to transition from a leadership role to the leadership role on climate change. Since then, over the last 3 years, China has accelerated action on climate commitments. It has increased its ambition to become climate carbon neutral by 2060 and has already put in place the world's biggest carbon trading market. By default, giving it a much greater say in setting the rules of the game for the world to follow. Now, as China takes a shot at becoming a climate superpower, the US has now re-entered the Paris Agreement in 2021. If there is any space for the dynamics to change, is yet to be seen. And this is just the beginning. Let's talk about the second pillar now. History tells us that modern economic giants have been driven by access to energy. Therefore, the quest for energy should also continue to shape the geopolitics of the 21st century. It should then not come as a surprise that the winners and losers will also be determined by the ability of countries to adapt to new sources of energy that are compatible with climate change. Let me break that down for you. You see, slowly but surely, the global acceptability for traditional energy sources such as fuel and coal is shrinking. Now, the only way forward to determine energy security sooner or later is to transition to greener energy sources, solar, wind, other renewables. Now, we all know that energy security in turn will determine a country's economic growth. In this case, it will not only offer a competitive edge, a competitive advantage for countries, but it will also usher in a new era of green jobs, winners again being the early movers. By the way, I'm not making any smart predictions over here. this development is already in motion. Let's take the example of solar energy. Over the last 2 decades, it has gone from being a fringe technology to finally generating the cheapest electricity in history. According to IRENA, the International Renewable Energy Agency, solar became 90% cheaper just in the last decade. The World Energy Outlook has estimated that as of 2020, solar technology now costs much less than new oil and gas plants being set up in some of the countries. In fact, by 2025, it will overtake coal as the world's biggest source of energy. How does the shift suddenly make business sense? Policies that have made renewables attractive to investors. Which country has benefited the most? China. By creating a niche for itself, it has not only become the largest user of solar energy at an installed capacity of 200 gigawatts, it has also become the largest exporter of the technology at $20 billion a year. The trigger? Climate change. The impact? China clearly on its way to shaping the global solar market. Speaking of markets, let me move to my third and final fundamental pillar. Climate change will also be a force that shapes 21st century trade. And this too will create winners and losers. Let's deep dive into this concept a little bit. Global trade today is worth nearly $19 trillion, and it's slowly warming up to the impacts of climate change. We are beginning to hear about emphasis on metrics such as food miles or the need to reduce carbon footprints from, say, transportation of food. Now, these trends and factors may slightly be adjusting the contours of the trading routes. But perhaps most importantly, somewhere hidden in all the louder messages, in a world when the space for carbon emissions is becoming limited, trade may begin to also be used as an instrument to make countries take action directly at home. Countries that have less stringent climate policies will be penalized for exporting into countries with stronger climate policies. So, in other words, what I'm saying is, whether you can afford it or not, you will have to bring down your trade emissions if you wish to continue to sell your goods to the rest of the world. Let me make this a little more real for you. The European Commission unveiled its Green Deal in 2019, through which, as early as 2021, it is possible that the EU introduces a mechanism to set carbon price on the import of selected items from outside the EU, hitting the profit margin of the poor producers in the developing countries. A form of a non-tariff barrier, this is going to take trade competition to an absolutely another level. Exporting countries need to sit up and take notice. Now, you may be wondering, where does this leave countries like Pakistan? You see, on an average, at least once every century, global disruptions take place in the shape of wars, revolutions, innovation. And when the dust settles, you witness the emergence of winners and losers. For this century, climate change clearly wins the disruption award. Now, the question really then for Pakistan becomes, does it really want to continue to treat the problem in isolation, like most other countries? Or does it actually see the big picture emerging? Frankly speaking, as the sixth most populated country in the world, I doubt we have the luxury to treat this matter as an afterthought. For Pakistan to win tomorrow, it needs to build on its climate action today. Not only for the sake of addressing climate alone, but to expand its trading goals, win the energy race, and reserve a role in the global leadership. Thank you.